the diagnosis of hydrosphalerosis is made by two different criteria. The first criteria is to have a single body cavity with accumulation of body fluid with the presence of subcutaneous edema that is greater than 5 millimeters thick. The other diagnostic criteria is to have a body cavity with fluid accumulation that are 2 in number with or without the presence of subcutaneous edema. The diagnosis of hydrosphalerosis has been made earlier during the antenatal period because of the advancement in ultrasound technology. So hydrosphalerosis can be classified into two. This is immune hydrosphalerosis, which occurs when there is the presence of maternal IgG antibodies that account for 10% of cases of hydrosphalerosis. The second category of hydrosphalerosis is the non-immune hydrosphalerosis that results from disorders that include cardiac, pulmonary, infectious, genetic, or other etiologies. And this diagnosis is made when a fetus is demonstrating features of hydrosphalerosis in the absence of circulating maternal antibodies. And this accounts for about 90% of cases of hydrosphalerosis. So to describe some of the etiologies, the first common cause of hydrosphalerosis, non-immune hydrosphalerosis, cardiovascular abnormalities. This can be structural, which include atrioceptal defects, endocardial cushion defects, and the other cardiovascular abnormalities that can happen in non-immune hydrosphalerosis are arrhythmias. It can be bradyarrhythmias, tachycardias, which can lead to high output failure and result in hydrosphalerosis. The other is vascular abnormalities that can lead to hydrosphalerosis. This includes sacrococcygeal teratomas. The other differential for a cause of non-immune hydrosphalerosis is the chromosomal abnormalities, and this accounts for 10% of non-immune hydrosphalerosis. And the most common cause for non-immune hydrosphalerosis is the monosomy X or the Turner syndrome, and followed by Edwards and Patau syndrome, which account for 10% each. And the mechanism may involve obstruction or incomplete formation of the lymphatic system in the neck, as in cystic hygroma, which may be seen in Turner syndrome. Another mechanism is cardiac failure related to congenital heart disease. This is present in 50 to 25% of aneuploidies. And the prognosis in the presence of congenital anomaly or chromosomal anomaly is very poor, and the mortality may be as high as 100%. The other category for a cause of non-immune hydrosphalerosis is hematological. This accounts for 20% of hydrosphalerosis, and this includes hematologic hemolysis, or defective red cell production, or abnormality in the production of hemoglobin. So the mechanism is thought to be because of high output cardiac failure. And there are some fetal anemias that are transient, and this anemia associated with parvovirus infection is an example. So whenever a woman have a parvovirus infection, this anemia is transient, and the fetus may revive from this non-immune hydrosphalerosis spontaneously. So aggressive therapy and surveillance are warranted in such cases, and the prognosis is very good, and if necessary, there is a place for intrauterine blood transfusion. And the other cause of non-immune hydrosphalerosis are infectious, which include cytomegalovirus infection, parvovirus infection, and torch infection. So in such group of patients, not all fetuses will develop hydrosphalerosis, and the development of hydrosphalerosis with torch infection reflects a multisystemic failure, and is a poor prognostic indicator because it affects not only the hematologic but also the liver and the kidneys, and most organ systems will be affected. So therapy in such cases is towards the infectious etiology. So a workup of patient with hydrosphalerosis includes antenatal and postnatal workup, and this workup includes detailed history and physical examination, laboratory tests, imaging, and some invasive procedures. And whenever possible, we have to avoid invasive procedures because they are associated with fetal loss. So the antenatal workup includes the history. A detailed history should be taken to the age, parity, gestational age, is any medication history, risk of sexually transmitted disease, thyroid disease or diabetes, and a previous fetal death. And also a hereditary and metabolic disease should be looked for, and congenital malformation in a previous child, and polyhydramnios in earlier pregnancies should be sought for during history taking. And during physical examination, we should focus on blood pressure measurement. All the vital signs are important, and fundal height to gestational age assessment should be comparable. Laboratory studies should include a complete blood count, blood group, and the risk of the mother. If she is Rh negative, the blood group of the partner should be known, as well as indirect culprits should be determined, and serology for throat infection, parvovirus, and syphilis should be done, and clear how PET test should also be performed, and thyroid function test and organ function test should also be performed. Imaging study, the most reliable imaging study in the diagnosis of fetal hydropsy is ultrasonography. Ultrasonography not only establishes the diagnosis of hydrops fetalis, but it also establishes amniotic fluid, placental thickness and location, the presence of congenital anomalies, or the presence of amniotic fluid, the amniotic fluid volume assessment, and the presence of twin gestation should be recorded. And the other use of ultrasonography in the workup of hydrops fetalis is to do a Doppler study of the umbilical artery and middle cerebral artery. In case of immune hydrops fetalis, with a fetal anemia, we will have increased peak systolic velocity in the middle cerebral artery. So Doppler study of the middle cerebral artery is warranted. The other importance of doing ultrasonography for hydrops fetalis is for fetal echocardiography. So there are some peculiar findings that will be found during ultrasonography in a fetus with hydrops fetalis. This includes ascites, generalized body edema.